for the opportunity that he has given us to share his word, and also for our vicar for giving me this opportunity to share word in this church and on this platform. My name, as has been said, is Geoffrey Odhiambo, and this morning I want to confess that I'm saved and Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior of my life. I want to speak about issues that God has put in my heart in the recent past. And I will title my theme as Refracted Reflection. I want you to look at the first week of this month. It was a week that was full of activities. In the world over, the world was celebrating Environmental Day, and that was on 5th of May. And the theme of this year was biodiversity. The same week, the church was celebrating its birthday on the Trinity Sunday. And then I kept asking myself, why do we need to remind ourselves of the environment? Why then do we need to remind ourselves of the birthday of our church, the Trinity Sunday? Why is it necessary for us to come to church? And I looked at the Bible and saw a drama that God has allowed to play out, and he became part of it. And in this drama, there is the first scene as the curtain draws, the righteous reflection. That everything God created, like it was read to us, was perfect. People perfectly reflected the Creator. God, after creating everything and he saw that it was good, decided to make man and woman and put them on the earth. And after he has created them and put them in the garden, he was so happy and he said it is very good. And that was his conclusion. I know it is very difficult for us to comprehend that perfect world that God had created from this our flawless and imperfect world. The world that God had created was completely a perfect world. It was a world where a perfect God would visit and mingle with it, the created things, and he had a perfect relationship with them. God had made man in his image, and so he was impressed that he can see something that looked like himself. What does it mean to be in God's image? It means to be in the structural essence and also functional elements of us, the way we are. That is the nine substances and the five senses. That was the form of God. And God had a perfect relationship with the things he had created. There was a vertical relationship, perfect. And he was very happy because man had a perfect relationship with him. So there was that perfect relationship between God and man, and man back to God. Then there was also a perfect relationship between God and the things he had created. And of course, between man and the things that God had created and given him for his care. And that was the horizontal relationship. And in this horizontal relationship, God had defined it in such a way that he wanted man to be responsible for the things he created. And so he gave man an opportunity to be part of his creation. And he said, all these things I've created, I've given them to you. Whatever name you will give them, that will be their name. And that made a perfect relationship between man and the created things. And there was no mistrust, no breach of relationship. The triangle between God, man, and the created things was perfect. Isaiah is trying to give us the picture of what had happened in the garden and the futuristic scene of what will happen. And in Isaiah 11:6, it says, the wolf will live with the lamb, the leopard will live with the goat, the calf with the lion, a cow will feed with a bear, child will put his hands in the viper's nest, and infants will play near cobra's den. They will neither harm or destroy each other, because lions will eat straw like an ox, and vipers will eat the dust. Perfection is also reflected on the first family, a perfect union. When God created the first lady and gave to the man saw the lady and said, true, this is the bone of my bone and the flesh of my flesh. He was very happy and he welcomed him with the two hands. Those statements speak volume about what is supposed to be our relationship, that we should be able to see each other as the bone of our bones and the flesh of our flesh, because we are both reflection of God. And so you see the other person as your reflection or a reflection of God. And therefore, we should be able to embrace them with that kind of a love. And that was scene one. Scene two comes where what God had created, a substance got in. And the reflection is now distorted. It is refracted. It's like putting an object in a glass with water. If you put an object in a glass with water, or any object in water, clean water, you will see that object appearing distorted. It is not going to have its original form. And this is the scene two. It opens with that darkness permeating the stage. Adam and Eve, who were good friends of God, are now in gloom and despair. They are now jotting out and trying to run away and hide from God. The universal destruction begins from willful thinking, and there is total rebellion, and the relationship between man and God broken, relationship between man and the created things broken. Our wills are corrupted. We no longer follow God's will. We pursue our selfish interest. Our understanding of God is blurred. We are controlled by our worldview and desires of the eyes. Our human relationship is stressful. We see people negatively, not as children of God. Our guardian of the created things is now distorted. We desire them for our selfish interest because we don't see them as things that God created and God saw as good. But we see as things which are supposed to serve us and serve our interest. Our feelings are bent. We are no longer controlled by God, the feeling of God, or desire for God. Our actions are inadequate. We no longer serve our God, but serve ourselves. What is the result of those kind of things? Like I've said, the result is total separation. And man now runs away from God in fear and guilt. And he runs and hides in the bushes. Like it says, the guilty are afraid. And therefore, the first couple runs away and starts to hide because of that guilt. We start having negative relationship with animals. Remember, we start now to eat animals, and therefore enmity between us and animal starts to generate and the created things. We now think that these things that God has created are supposed to serve us and serve our interest. Pain during childbirth crops in as a sign of better relationship between human beings. Discord between man and the cosmos, the universe, and the entire human race is distorted, as portrayed by the cursed ground. And so man is cursed, and man is asked that he shall eat from the sweat of his brow until he returned to dust. And in pursuit of that easy life that he got in the garden, man started destroying the creation and disturbed the cosmos. But even with all that distorted image of God, we still have a great mirror of the Creator. The image is still appearing, like an image will appear in a water, but distorted, so our image of God is still reflected, but the image appear distorted. Then the sin three crops in, and the curtain opens, and there is hope, because there is rejuvenated reflection, that distorted reflection is being straightened, is being made pure, and the promise that the seed of a woman shall strike the head of the serpent dead appears, and Christ comes in that form, and as a redeemer, sacrificing for us to restore us to that original creation. Justice and hope is offered at the cross, that there is life once again. Prophet Haggai says in Haggai 2:9, that the glory of the present house, and the house is us, and the house is the world that God gave us, will be greater than the glory of the former house. And in this place, I will grant peace. That once again, even though man is guilty and runs around, and even though man feels disturbed and does not have peace, he gives us hope, that he will grant us that hope once again, and through his son Jesus Christ right now. And he says, but for you to get that, give careful thoughts to your ways. Give careful thoughts to your ways. Remember, you still live in that object, and you still appear distorted. I've come to make you straight, and you must also accept to be straightened. And God gave us a glimpse view of what he was trying to do in Genesis chapter 6, where he brings flood, and in that flood, his aim was not to destroy the world, but to bring up a new creation. And how is he going to give a new creation? He told Ark to build an ark. He told Noah to build an ark. And in that ark, all the animals was to get into it, to be rescued. And so the picture of man taking care of nature comes in again, and they live in the ark for many days without eating each other, because the animals went in two by two. So he could not have eaten even a chicken, because otherwise life could have been distorted once again. So he tries to restore that the ark has come to save the human race, and is trying to bring back what he had created in the first place, that man and created things are a perfect union. And Noah with his children are going to have perfect union for 40 years quarantine in an ark. And therefore, that was an opportunity for them. And then the post-flood restoration reflects that future comprehensive reconciliation that God has planned for us. That how you live in the ark, you should extend that life outside the ark. Remembering that you lived here perfectly for those many days, and you need to extend that life outside this ark. And in Genesis 8, God gives us and gives that family a covenant that he will never again destroy earth with water. And so he says, wherever you see the rainbow set on the sky, it reminds me, and it should remind you, of the covenant that we have had together, that never again, and that you should live in harmony like you lived in the ark. Now, Christ's atonement was far superior and permanent than the Noahic and Mosaic covenant. And that is the greatest hope that we have as Christians, that Christ has come to restore us and is will be more permanent and more superior than the ones we have received in the past. And this third scene of rejuvenated reflection is summarized in God's plan for comprehensive reconciliation, like we have read in Colossians 1, 19 to 23. Here, God brings a picture in verse 19 and 20 of a sacrifice Christ to help us, to get us out of our sins. And it was a total sacrifice that he gave to bring us. If you read that verse, it was supposed to redeem us and restore that relationship between us and himself and us and nature, the created things. And if you read the same Colossians, verse 23, he gives us a picture that even though Christ gave us that atonement, it is supposed to be a daily life. It should be our way of life, that we should work our salvation, we should work our faith on a daily basis. And he tells us that the salvation that I gave does not end on the cross, but you also need to have your personal initiative to achieve that ultimate goal of salvation that I've planned for you. And therefore, he tries to remind us of that our daily reconciliation with him. Man ran away from God, and because of that, there is strife among men. And when you see those strife, it should remind you that you should have a daily reconciliation with me. Remember, he tells us that the sun should not go down if you have an issue with a brother or if you are a brother before you reconcile. And that reminds us that you should have that daily walk with God. When you realize mistrust, it is a reminder that you need to reconcile with God and your neighbor. Today, there is a lot of war cries all over the world. Today, nations rise against nations. These are not meant to punish us. They are meant to remind us that we need to reconcile with God, because that is our nature. It is our current distorted reflection of God. There is tribal and land clashes all over. We keep hearing all these things. And there's tribal animosity. Wherever there are two or three communities gathering together, you will see there is some kind of tension amongst them. And people talk negatively about each other. We have seen the racism in the US about the blacks. These are signs and reminders of how far we have fallen, and that we need to reconcile with God on a daily basis. Just this week, we heard about these 4,000 underage girls who got pregnant in a country in Kenya. And this should be a reminder of how far we have fallen. The red streets we have all over our towns are a reminder of how much we have fallen. And it is calling upon us to reconcile on a daily basis. As we see those things, they should remind us of the covenant of reconciliation. We hear about corruption and we see corruption in our everyday life, and we sometimes participate in them. We have also heard and seen the police killing and the killings within our community, sons killing their parents, and brothers killing brothers. These are examples of how far we have fallen. We saw the fightings among the MCAs, and of course, the very bitter and uncouth talk in the legislation assemblies, both in Senate and in National Parliament. These are examples of what we have, and it's a reminder for us to reconcile with God. Wherever we see those things, the sun should not go down before we meet God and ask for reconciliation. In Romans 8, verses 18 to 23, give us a picture of the created things groaning, and asking for deliverance from the sin of destruction. And he tells us that the created things are feeling the pain, like the pain of a childbirth. If you read those verses, you will get that message. That they need to be reconciled with us and to be reconciled with God and be restored. And God keeps reminding us that nature is groaning and requires to be reconciled with. When we see floods, it's a reminder that we need to reconcile with nature. What has caused it? When we see the blood red waters and rivers, it is a reminder, and the choking lakes and rivers. These are reminders of how far we have fallen from our responsibility of taking care of man. We have failed in our faith. When we see locusts, this is a reminder that God had created things perfectly and had put everything in its rightful place. But because we have disturbed the places where these things live, they are looking for a new host. And so the locusts go everywhere looking for a new host. And in the end, we suffer. When we get about these viruses, they live somewhere which we have disturbed, because they have not come from nowhere. They have come from somewhere. We have disturbed those places, and these things are looking for host. Nature is reminding us that you are supposed to take care of me, but look at how far you have fallen, and now I am groaning, I'm suffering, like during a childbirth. When we see animal-human conflict, it is a reminder that we have fallen in doing our proper duty of managing those resources. When there is climate change and we no longer are able to get good harvest, when we are unable to live the normal life we used to have, the kind of crops we used to have, the kind of animals we used to keep, we are unable to have them. That is a reminder. When we have drought, that is a reminder of how far we have distorted and we have destroyed the things that God has given into our possession to take care of. But verse 22 give us a hope of the same Colossians chapter 1, that there is ultimate reconciliation that will happen if we live faithfully by daily reconciling within ourselves and nature. And I want to give you an analogy of marriage to explain what I'm trying to say here. That in our marriage, we go to the altar to say, I do, just like we say when we get saved and we get close to Christ, that we say, I do, to that Christ, that he becomes part of us. That I do does not end at the altar. The I do we say in our marriage, and the I do we say for accepting Christ. We have to live daily with that I do. Our thoughts must reflect that. The yes that we said means that we have said no to anybody else. And the yes that we have said to God means that we have said no to any other God that will interfere with us. And that is the analogy that shows what God had planned by giving us marriage, of the kind of faith we need to have. That as much the way we resolve our issues in our marriage on a daily basis is the same way we need to resolve our issues on a daily basis with our God and the created things. Remember, in your anger, do not sin. Do not sin. In your anger, do not sin. Nor let the sun go down before you solve it. And so as we do that in our marriages, we need to do that in our relationship with nature and God. The submission, the way we submit to each other, is the same way we need to submit to God and to nature on a daily basis. Those are responsibilities that if we keep doing them, then they become our lifestyle and our behaviors, and therefore it will make us to grow closer and closer to God. Remember, the I do in marriage last till death do us part. The same way the I do in our faith last till death do us part. In conclusion, I want to say that give careful thought to your ways, and the glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house. And in this place, I will grant peace, says the Lord, like we have read in Haggai 2:9. The glory of our present cosmos will be greater than the glory of the former, and I will grant you peace. The current circumstances is not meant to punish anyone, but to draw us back to God. And then if we get back to God, then the glory of this present world will be greater than the glory of the former world. And in this world, God will grant us peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jeffrey, for such a great one that we need to reconcile. And as